your way back, remain standing. We're going to go ahead and with our worship. And guys, we're going to sing Power in the Blood. Man, aren't you excited for what God has done for us through the cross of Jesus Christ? And there is power in that, isn't there? Let's sing about that this morning. It's hymn 132 in your Baptist hymnal, Power in the Blood. You can be seated for a moment. Welcome to Immanuel Southern Baptist Church. We are excited to have you here, whether it's in person or watching us online. You are our church family, and we're excited to have you here with us this morning. All right, just want to give you a reminder. First of all, we are going to be doing communion today. So those of you that are home, if you want to join us, now would be a good time to get you a cracker and some juice. Okay, it doesn't have to be anything specific, but we do invite you to do communion with us there at home, and we will be doing that here. Just a couple of reminders. Don't forget, next Sunday on Resurrection Celebration, we will have our Easter sunrise service out here in the pavilion at 8 o'clock. Then we'll have breakfast at 9, and then Sunday school and worship will be at regular times, 9:45 and 10:45. So invite each other, invite somebody else to come and be a part of that special time celebrating the resurrection of Jesus Christ, the greatest event in all of history, isn't it? And so the most significant event, and we'll talk more about that later on. All right, so keep those things in mind. Don't forget those that are planning on being part of Vacation Bible School. There is a VBS clinic coming up pretty soon at First Baptist Church in West Plains. On April the 12th, on that Monday night. And so keep that in mind, be a part of that as well. And most of the other announcements you already know or you're in the bulletin. So let's go ahead and we're going to have a word of prayer, and then we'll get started with our worship service. Brother Mike, would you lead us in prayer, please?
brings God with us. At church and school, at home, at play. We can find God in everything. Don't believe me? Watch this.
Good morning, everybody. I've got a little ball here. It's a representative, if you would, because it's supposed to represent the moon, and I didn't think I could fit the moon in here. It's a little bit big, you know. And the moon is pretty big, isn't it? I mean, it's big. It's old. I mean, it's been around since God created it how long ago? And it's just really neat how beautiful the moon is and get to look at it and stuff like that. And I brought another thing with me. This is a LED light bulb. Now, this is pretty new. This is new technology, and I mean, it's got all kinds of stuff that's gotten put inside of it so it can be energy efficient, and it's just the latest, greatest technology. But you know, there's nothing about this light bulb really nothing that make you want to hang it on the Christmas tree. You know, it and the moon, you know, nothing that you want to hang it on the Christmas tree either. I mean, it's pretty and stuff like that. But you know, the thing is, both of these in themselves, they were designed. They were created to reflect or to give out. The light bulb here was designed to screw into a lamp, and then when you turn the power on, it lights up the room. And the other day, we were coming home, and it was late at night, we're driving home, and it was so pretty because the moon had come out from behind the earth. And so it was reflecting the sun and was lit up. And you could see just about as good as you could. You know, the car doesn't let me turn off the lights, but every once in a while I get on a county road or something like that in the pickup and turn the lights off and just drive down the county road because it's so bright out there from the moon. It's so neat out there. When you go flying, you can do night flights, but if you do it when the moon's out, it's as bright as day out there, and it's really neat. So, you know, that's what they were kind of designed. And, you know, that's kind of like us. Some of us have been around forever. Especially, that's what the kids keep saying. You've been around forever. And some of us are still new technology. But you know, we've all been created by God. We're pretty awesome as it stands. But all of us have been created to show the world the light of God's love and to share with the world who God is. And the only way that we can do that, there's nothing in us. I mean, you can see the moon when it's not being lit by the sun, but it's very dark. You just can't hardly make it out, but you can see it. But there's nothing that attracts. And this here, you know, but when it's doing what it was designed, when the power is coming through this, or when the moon is reflecting the sun, it lights up the world. And the world can see. The world can see where it's at. And that's what God wants us to do. He wants us to show the world love. So, are you willing to show them how much God loves you and loves them? Let's fold our hands and close our eyes. Jesus, thank you for coming and living. Thank you for being God. that gives us light. Help us to show the world where we live your light. Bless these ones here. Bless the moms and dads, Lord, as they try to show their little ones light. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
So here's your challenge for search for God in everything. You'll be amazed where you'll find Him.
Thing I forgot to ask. I remember a couple of weeks ago somebody talking about carrying the cross. Are there still plans to do that this coming Friday? I know usually on. Okay. Yeah, it'll be this Friday. Okay, so what time do we usually start at? 7? Is it 7 that we started at? So anybody that wants to, usually from 7 to what we go, noon? Is that what we went to, I think, last time? Something like that, isn't it? So if you can come for the whole time or for an hour or so, usually we do the carry the cross over across the highway there by the conical on that side, okay, is usually where our people line up. Sometimes there'll be others at other corners, but most of us line up over there. So anyway, so if you can come be a part of that, it's a wonderful testimony. It's neat hearing people drive by and honking at you and letting you know that they appreciate the message of the cross. Okay, so it'll be taking place Friday. So again, 7 to noon, if you can come for the whole time, great. If you can come for an hour or so, that'd be fine too. All right, if you have your hymnals, go ahead and turn to hymn number 122. And go ahead and stand with me. We're going to kind of be a little bit different type of service today. Okay, everything is going to flow together all leading up to communion. Okay, and talk about the reason we do it and setting the stage for, of course, resurrection celebration next week. But this will be a time of reflection and remembering what God has done for us through Jesus Christ. And so we're going to set that stage by singing Tell Me the Story of Jesus. And you'll see why here in just a little bit.
Yeah.
You can be seated for a little bit. You know, this may sound strange to us who've grown up in church, and those of us that are here now, and I know most everybody here are regular attenders, and a lot of you that are watching this online are regular attenders as well. But something, several years back really struck a nerve with me that opened my eyes to something. Here, since I'd grown up in church, knew all the stories of Jesus. We were doing vacation Bible school at a church, and I think we shared the story of maybe Noah or David and Goliath, one of those big stories that most everybody knows, so I thought. We had several, not just one or two, but several people in our church, kids, that had never heard the story of whichever one it was, either Noah or David and Goliath. You know what I realized for the first time? That we are raising a whole generation of people that don't know the stories of God. They don't know the stories that you and I grew up with. There's many people, in fact, did you know China sends missionaries to the United States because they consider us an unreached people group? And when you look at statistics and see the decline in church memberships, the decline in attendance, the decline in baptisms, and then you look in our world, we've got young adults that have never, ever been in a church. Guys, we've got to start opening our eyes that the story of Jesus is something new to a lot of people nowadays. I can't tell you what a shock that was for me to realize that and finally come to that understanding. Guys, we have the most powerful love story that's ever been written. And so many people don't know it. They don't know what this church is all about and the message that we try to present. And so I wanted to start off by sharing that song and just to remind you, because did you notice all three of those verses talked about the different stages of Jesus' life? You know, I want us to look this morning. You know, we've been talking about encountering Christ. And we've shared some stories from when Jesus was alive and how when he encountered people, man, he changed their life, didn't he? It was incredible. But I want us this morning to focus, and we are going to encounter the ultimate love, because all the things in the messages we've looked at in the past, Jesus showed love when he healed, didn't he? He showed love when he forgave. He showed love when he restored sight and all those kind of things. But guys, I want us this morning to focus on encountering the ultimate love of Christ. Okay? Because that's what the whole gospel message is about. So we were going to start looking at those first couple verses of that song. And guys, God showed his love for us just by coming to this earth. Have you ever thought of that? Man, I think of, there was a song long time ago, and I used to sing it. And I don't even know if I remember all the words, but it was called If That Isn't Love. And it talks about how Jesus being in heaven, having all the angels ministering to him and serving him, everything perfect. And yet, because of his love for us, he gave all of that up and came to this earth where he knew he was going to be rejected, mocked, beaten, and crucified. He knew that. And yet, because he loved us so much, he was willing to do that. And then, when he came, the King of Kings, the Creator of the universe, not only came as one of us, his creation, but guess what? He came as the lowest of his creation. he wasn't born in a palace. He didn't ride a white stallion everywhere he went. He didn't have people to minister to every need. In fact, we see Jesus doing just the opposite, don't we? We see him take on the form of a servant, washing his disciples' feet, even the ones he knew was going to reject him. We see him being with the lepers, the outcast, the ones that were beneath everybody else in society. Man, Jesus showed love when he came to this earth, didn't he? And, you know, you read the first few chapters of the gospel stories, and actually halfway through or so, Jesus' popularity just grew and grew. And it's amazing, anytime you watch any of the stories about Jesus, any of the movies, and you read the gospel accounts, you know what you find? Crowds. It says that people flocked from all over to hear Jesus because he actually lived out what he preached and taught. He showed love so much so that people wanted to be around Jesus. Isn't that awesome to think about? You know, there's a new series on Jesus out, and if you haven't seen it, I challenge you to look up on YouTube the series called The Chosen. I think it's one of the best that I've ever seen because the way they portray Jesus, I remember the first time I watched one of those, I'm like, that's a guy I would want to hang out with right there. You know, most of the other stories you see about Jesus, he's always this very sincere guy that, you know, holiness, and you think, okay, I don't want to get too close to him. I like him. I like what he's doing. But man, this series on this Chosen series, it's like, that's a guy I would be best friends with. Man, I just want to be like that. And that's the way Jesus was, though. People wanted to hear him. They wanted to be with him. They wanted to... It's just awesome to have a relationship with Jesus. Why? Because they knew that he loved them. It's an awesome, awesome thing. And I just realized I forgot to dismiss our younger group down to children's church, our young kids. All right. So, anyway, so Jesus showed love for us by coming to this earth. Okay? Giving up all those splendors of heaven, coming to this earth to serve us, to bring healing to us. Man, we saw the encounters when we've done our series, our sermon series. Jesus healed a lot of people, didn't he? He restored their hope. And a lot of times the things he did was for people who were in a hopeless situation. But another reason people followed Jesus, his teachings. You know, there are people who don't even accept Christianity, but they believe Jesus' teachings were awesome. Man, you'll hear other religions, even Eastern occult and all these kind of things that talk about the teachings of Jesus, because guess what? Because the teachings were so genuine. They were so anti the rest of the world. They were focused on ministering and serving and helping each other. And so his teachings, people still follow his teachings that don't even believe in Jesus Christ or in Christianity. To me, that's just amazing that his teachings were that sincere and that strong and that powerful. So he showed his love by showing us a better way to live. And I know I've said this before, but I know sometimes, and don't get me wrong, this is ultimately what we're looking for. Looking to is the cross. But, guys, part of the reason Jesus came is so he could identify with us. Think about that for a minute. Aren't you glad that when you pray to God, that you are praying to someone who understands completely? He really does. Because why? Because he was here in the form of Jesus. When you suffer rejection, and how many of us have suffered rejection? Every one of us, right? Aren't you glad that you can pray to God who understands exactly how you feel? He says, hey, I know what you're going through. How many times you share a prayer request with somebody and you have somebody tell you that, but they've not been where you are. We all have. Okay? They mean well. Okay? But when we pray to Jesus and we talk to Him about what we're going through, He can say, hey, I've been there. In fact, we talk about rejection. Jesus experienced it way more than any of us ever will. Okay? How about when we go through hurts and disappointments and all of those things? There's nothing you can bring before God that He cannot say to you, hey, I understand what you're going through. In fact, the Bible says He was tempted just like we are. Woo. Sometimes as a man, I think, okay, Jesus surely didn't go through that. Yes, He did. He was tempted the same way we are. Everything you feel, Jesus has felt. Man, to me, that's one of the most awesome things to think about. That He showed His love by coming to this earth. And by His teaching and building relationships with people and accepting the unaccepted in society and bringing hope by restoring and healing and all of those things and teaching about another kingdom, guess what? He brought hope in a hopeless situation. The Jews pretty much had given up a lot on believing in the Messiah. They still taught about it, but 400-something years between the Old Testament and the New Testament. That's longer than our nation's been in existence. Over 400 years, they waited for the promise of the Messiah. And things got worse and worse. Rome was cruel to the Jews. Okay, it wasn't just a casual relationship that they had that, hey, you pay us taxes and you guys do whatever. No. Guys, I know some of our prayer requests and things we were talking about today, our world is in a bad shape right now. There's hopelessness. There's despair. We shared some of the things that are going on in court cases and different things. And aren't you glad that our hope is not in this world? Jesus came to teach us there's something different, something else ready to happen. In fact, when He preached, what did He say? The kingdom of heaven is here. Now, this is Palm Sunday. Jesus' popularity was at its height. And we know when He came in His very last week, okay, everything Jesus did, even though He ministered to all these people, He always had the cross in mind, knowing that that's what He came ultimately to do. He reached that point in His ministry. It was just about time. His last week of being on this earth in the form of Jesus. And what did He do before His crucifixion? He rode into Jerusalem, and He was at the height of His popularity. People were laying palm branches down. They were ready to make Jesus their king. That's how popular Jesus was. They were ready to make Him their king. And yet, what do we see happen in just about 4 days? Those same people that were crying, Hosanna, Son of David, and trying to make Him their king, you know what they were saying 4 days later? Crucify. Crucify. I want us to look at a responsive reading. 682, if you're following along in your hymnal, it'll be up on the screen as well, I believe. Okay? I'll read the first part, and then you guys read responsively behind me. This is the gospel message. This is scripture that we're looking at. Okay? I believe most of the entry is found in John 11, but all right. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of His disciples, saying to them,
go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here.
If anyone asks you, why are you doing this? Tell him, the Lord needs it, and he will send it back here shortly.
They went and found the colt outside in the street, tied at a doorway. As they untied it, some people standing there asked, what are you doing untying that colt?
They answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go.
And they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it. He sat on it.
Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches they had cut in the fields.
And those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, Hosanna.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest.
All right. There in Mark, most of that's found in Mark chapter 11. And just tells the story, what we've already said, that Jesus at the height of his popularity. And again, the reason he was so popular is because he showed genuine love. I wonder if you and I really showed that kind of love to people out here in the world, what a difference we would make. If they did not doubt our motives, if they knew every time they saw somebody from Immanuel Southern Baptist Church, that they say, man, those are people, I want whatever they have. Guys, we're starting to see that. Part of the reason we do our soul food ministry is to build relationships with people. We've been earning trust. And I tell you what, yesterday we've ministered to twice as many people as we have in the last 2 months. And you know what? I think we had twice as many prayer requests, at least, maybe more than that. It was almost every car that came by said, hey, will you pray for me about this? And a lot of times we didn't even have to ask them, hey, do you have a prayer request? A lot of times they just shared it. Guys, when this world starts seeing that we care about them, then they start listening to our message that Jesus loves them. I heard somebody say, and you probably have heard it too, that they don't care how much we know until they know how much we care. And that's true. We live in that kind of society that people want results. They want to see things demonstrated, don't they? They don't want to just hear us talk about God's love. They want us to show it to them. And so building relationships with them, ministering to the kind of people that Jesus did. Sometimes it's the ones that nobody else is ministering to. Okay? It's paying attention to them. It's building genuine relationships. When they see us fighting and gossiping and all that kind of stuff, that just sends them the other direction. Okay? They want that genuine love. So remember, Christ showed his love by coming to this earth. I want you now look at responsive reading 131. Because we can see how quickly things change. It'll be up on the screen too if you didn't want to turn there. And those that are home listening, I don't know if you can see the screen. Okay, it is on the screen, so y'all can just read along however you want to with us. All right. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged. The soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on his head. They clothed him in a purple robe and went up to him again and again, saying, Hail, King of the Jews!
And they struck him in the face.
And when Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe, Pilate said to them, Here is the man. As soon as the chief priests and their officials saw him, they shouted,
Crucify! Crucify!
Finally, Pilate handed him over to them to be crucified. So the soldiers took charge of Jesus. Carrying his own cross, he went out to the place of the skull, which in Aramaic is called Golgotha.
Here they crucified him, and with him two others, one on each side, and Jesus in the middle.
And Pilate had a notice prepared and fastened to the cross. It read,
Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews.
Later, knowing that all was now completed, and so that the scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said,
I am thirsty.
A jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on a stalk of the hyssop plant, and lifted it to Jesus' lips. When he had received the drink, Jesus said,
It is finished. With that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit.
Most of that's come from the Gospel of John. It's just scriptures. One verse here and a verse here put together a little bit of the story of the crucifixion. You know, and you think about how just 4 days prior, they were worshiping. He was at the height of his popularity. And you wonder why they so quickly turned and how they could turn to that point, not only rejecting his message, but calling for his death. Guys, have you ever noticed in some of the riots that have happened in America in the last year or so, the violence that is associated with the mob mentality? People doing things that they normally would never do. They say that there's a mentality that goes with it, and sociologists and others have studied this, and they said, you can find somebody who is very peaceful, and yet once you get them in a crowd like that, sometimes it is so easy to influence somebody to do something totally against their nature because of that mob mentality that goes on. Okay, of course, we know there were supernatural forces behind this too, and the forces of evil were definitely at work. And it was God's plan, okay? We understand that part of it. But from a human perspective, why were they so easily swayed? Have you ever had something in your life turn out way different than you ever expected it to? Every one of us have, haven't we? Okay? You may put your hope in something and hope, man, I think things should go this way. And we even kind of plan our lives that way sometimes, don't we? Did you notice life is full of interruptions? Full of things that makes us sometimes change the course of our life? We all do, don't we? We've all had those instances. If you haven't yet, you will. Okay? Many people, in fact, the week before Jesus entered into Jerusalem, there are several accounts of Jesus asking people to follow him. And he's still very popular. And there was a couple instances people said, Jesus, I'm going to follow you wherever you go. And Jesus said, now wait a minute. He said, first, you got to realize, I don't even have a home. I don't have a place to call my own. That may be what I ask of you. Are you still willing to go? He asked another one, he said, I want you to sell everything that you have, give to the poor, and then come follow me. Others, and there are several stories that go on, and it says one by one, people began going the other way, and they started leaving Jesus. That's kind of sobering. It's something we just kind of read through, and we don't pay much attention. But when you put it in context to what all is happening in Jesus' life, here's what he's reminding them. You remember what most of the Jews' expectation of the Messiah was? Most of their expectation was that the Messiah was going to come and free them from Rome. They thought he was going to be a military leader, a political leader. We kind of in America have kind of put our hopes in politics, it seems, don't we? Even Christians. It distraughts me to realize how much hope and faith we put in a political party. And yet Jesus is reminding them, hey, my kingdom is not of this world. He begins showing, telling parables and illustrations that, hey, my kingdom is not going to be a physical kingdom like this, but instead it is a spiritual kingdom with much more significance. Guys, as important as this world is, and it is important, isn't it? It is important that we have godly leaders and godly laws, okay? And we need to work towards that. But believer, we should never forget that is not the most important thing in life. Eternity is far more important than who wins a Super Bowl. It is far more important than who wins an election. I'm glad the Hogs won last night, but we're going to forget about it. Next year, I don't even remember who won last year. Okay? All those things are insignificant compared to eternity. And so the expectation, Jesus was telling them, hey, it's not going to be a kingdom like you think. In fact, even his own disciples had that problem, didn't they? Remember James and John coming to Jesus and say, hey, Jesus, when you set up kingdom, man, we want to be number two and number three. And Jesus said, hey, you don't even know what you're asking. He said, to be greatest in my kingdom means to be servant of all. Man, that blew their expectations. They didn't know what to do about that. They struggled with that, didn't they? How many of you have expected Jesus to work a certain way in your life? We all have, haven't we? If we're honest, we expect Jesus to give us an easy life and to have no struggles. It'd be great if that were true, isn't it? Wouldn't it? But those of us that have been around any time, we know that's just not true. That health, wealth, if you're living for me, everything's going to be perfect. We know better than that. The Bible does not teach that at all, does it? And sometimes it can get so bad, our faith gets shaken, doesn't it? Our faith gets shaken. There's many times that believers, church members, maybe believers, maybe not, but church members, what happens? Their expectations get blown and they end up leaving the church. We see it happen all the time, don't we? You ask some of them, sometimes they'll tell you. Well, expectations don't always go the way that we want them to go. Jesus reminds them. In fact, those last couple of weeks of Jesus' life, he began preaching more and more that, and telling his disciples more and more that he was going to be dying on the cross. If you read the gospel accounts, you see that happening. Every time towards the end, right before the crucifixion, he's telling them more and more, trying to prepare them. Guys, I'm coming for a whole different reason. See, he showed his love by coming the first time. But his ultimate love was about to be shown. Because to die for those who would reject him, those who would seek him out because they wanted to be fed bread and fishes miraculously, those that had expectations of Jesus, and when those expectations weren't met, what'd they do? Then they start crying, crucify. They lose their hope and their faith. Those that would deny him, those that would betray him, those that would mock him, beat him, reject him. Man, I think this is the perfect time. Every year, you ought to watch the Passion of the Christ at least once a year, I think. Because of all the stories in the movies of Jesus, the Passion of the Christ portrays the crucifixion probably closer to anyone else. Let's sing, and you don't have to stand for this, but we're going to sing the Old Rugged Cross. You know, there's a reason this is one of a lot of people's favorite songs. Okay? The old rugged cross, hymn 141. Somebody once said that he came to die so that we could live. Sums up why Jesus really came, doesn't it? Yes, I'm glad he came for all those other reasons, to identify with us, to have it teach us good things, but I'm so thankful that he came to die. Now, Jesus didn't just die a martyr's death. There was purpose in the death of Jesus. See, sin separated man from holy God. And we see that from the very beginning. In fact, it amazes me that God created us knowing that we would sin. I had somebody ask, so why does all this evil happen if God is such a God of love? Guys, it's important for us to remember why God created us. He had the angels that served him constantly. They had to. God created man in his own image. And in doing so, he gave us free will. Because guess what? If he forced us to love him, that's not real love, is it? If you put a gun to somebody's head and tell them to love you, that's not real love, is it? Okay? He created us with free will. With free will also means we have the right to choose to reject too, doesn't it? And guys, that's what sin is all about. That's why there's sin and evil in the world, because the Bible tells us our hearts are evil and we desire. How many of you have to teach your kids to lie and to be selfish? No, we have to teach them to be good and to tell the truth, don't we? And to share. Because sin has run rampant. We let it take place in our hearts. I remember talking, there's been many times I've counseled people about sin in their life, and they tell me this, well, I just want to do what I want to do. We've probably heard our young people say that. We probably have said that. And if we haven't said it, we at least meant it in our hearts, haven't we? I just want to do what I want to do. Free will. God doesn't force you to do anything. He doesn't force you to love him and to repent. But sin separated us from a holy God. Somebody said, well, why does God send people to hell? He doesn't. Hell was created. Did you know hell was created for Satan and his demons? Somebody else, I heard the same person also say, God doesn't send us there. We're already on our way there. He sent Jesus to die for us so we don't have to go to hell. See, guys, that is the difference. That's important for us to remember. God loved you so much, knowing that we are stubborn, and we are, aren't we? Knowing that we want to do things our own way, knowing that we don't want to humble ourselves and confess and repent, he still sent Jesus to die on the cross so that we can have forgiveness of sin. Isn't that awesome to think about? Guys, that's the ultimate love. Knowing that people are going to reject and to still love them enough to die for them? Whew. There is nobody that loves you as much as God loves you. Nobody. Your mom may love you, your wife or girlfriend, whoever may love you, but they don't love you near as much as God loves you. Okay? And that's the whole reason he came. Now, how do we receive that forgiveness? Man, that's part of the news. We don't have to earn it. Because you know what? We can't be good enough to earn it. We can't be good enough to earn God's love or forgiveness. Man, there's people that would love us if we jumped through all the right hoops. But God's not that way. God's not that way. He knows we can't be good enough. Because guess what? Even at our best, we're still not very good, are we? We're not. And yet, Christ loved us so much, he gave himself for it. You say, well, how do I receive that forgiveness? First of all, you know, when we do VBS, we've talked about that a lot today. We share with the kids a little ABC. A stands for admit. That means admit what? Admit that we have sinned. That means to be in agreement with God that we have sinned. Call sin, sin. Don't call it a sickness or illness. Don't blame somebody else. Guys, you know what I've discovered? We like to blame other people for our sins. Well, I wouldn't have done this if they wouldn't have done that. It means we take full responsibility for our sins. Okay? And it means to not minimize it either. Because a lot of times we do that, don't we? We say, well, my sin wasn't that bad, but boy, look at theirs. Okay? No, it means to be in agreement with God, saying, I take responsibility for my sin. And God, it's bad. Because guess what? All sin is bad in God's eyes. Because He looks to the heart. Why do we gossip? Because we're evil. We're wicked. Okay, we want to hurt people. We want to build ourselves up. Guess what? That's pretty wicked. We don't think of it that way, do we? So we admit, we're in agreement with God that we have sinned. Romans 3:23 tells us what? For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. It doesn't say for all y'all have sinned. It said all. Every single one of us. We've come short of God's glory. B stands for believe. What do we believe? That God loved us so much. Knowing how stubborn and sinful we are, we believe that He loved us and came to this earth in the form of Jesus. See, it's important we believe Jesus is God. Because if He was just a man, His death on that cross didn't mean anything. But because Jesus was God in the flesh, His death on that cross was able to bring atonement and forgiveness for all the sins of the entire world, past, present, and future. But He had to be God to do that. Your sin and your death and my death wouldn't have accomplished that, would it? Okay, so we got to believe that. And not only believe it here in our head, but believe it in our heart. That means we trust in it, which leads to C. It means to confess. What does it mean to confess? It means we say it to God. And we say it to others. That's why we get baptized. We're telling other people what has happened in our life. Okay? And you say, well, how do I say that, something like that, to God? Well, every head bowed and every eye closed, it's something like this. Dear God, I'm so thankful that You love me. And Lord, I know that I have sinned. And I am so sorry. I realize my sin is an affront to You. The best way I know how, I repent from my sin and turn from it. I ask You to help me to live for You from this point on. I believe that You came to this earth in the form of Jesus, lived a sinless life, and died on the cross so that I could receive forgiveness of sin. We must, first of all, examine ourselves. Okay? Communion is for believers. So we just prayed for those that received Jesus Christ as their Savior just now. You can participate in communion. We do open communion here. You don't have to be a member of this church. If you're a believer, we invite you to do communion with us. Okay? The
The Bible says be very careful that we examine ourselves first. So believer, first of all, if there's someone here that has not, that just now prayed to receive Christ, I invite you to come and tell me that. And we'll be happy to pray with you. But for the rest of us, okay, it's a time for us to examine ourselves. It's time for us as Christians to still confess and repent of sin in our hearts right now. Ask the Holy Spirit to search you. Remember David prayed that. Search my heart, O God. Show me any unclean way inside of me. I've got a feeling every single one of us in this room have a sinful area we struggle with. It's a time to confess it with God. Ask for His help. Repent of it. Okay, He doesn't want you to be bound to that. Ask Him to show you that. But it's also a time to remember. Once you've done that, it's a time for us to remember what He's done. Get those images in your mind, that picture of from the Passion of the Christ. As our deacons come, you stay with your heads bowed. It's a time of reflection and examination. Our deacons are going to come, and they're going to pass out elements. And you at home that are going to participate with you, this is for you to get that cracker and juice ready. And while they are doing that, and while you are confessing, repenting, examining yourself, and while you're remembering what Christ has done, and while they pass these elements out, I want you to listen to the words of this song. And this will help you get that image in your mind of what Jesus went through for us. Walking down the road to Jerusalem, the time had come to sacrifice again. My two small sons, they walked beside me down the road. The reason that they came was to watch the Lamb. Daddy, Daddy, what have we seen there? There's so much that we don't understand. So I told them of Moses, Father Abraham. Then I said, dear children, watch the Lamb. For there would be so many in Jerusalem today. We must make sure the Lamb doesn't run away. Then I told them of Moses and Father Abraham. Then I said, dear children, watch the Lamb. When we reached the city, I knew something must be wrong. There were no joyful worshipers, no joyful worship songs. I stood there with my children in the midst of angry men. Then I heard the crowd cry out, crucify Him. We tried to leave the city, but we could not get away. Forced to play in this drama, a role I did not wish to play. Why were we still standing here? Soon they would even now they come. The first one cried for mercy. The people gave him none. The second one was violent. He was arrogant and loud. I can still hear his angry voice screaming at the crowd. Then someone said, "There's Jesus," and I scarce believed my eyes. A man so badly beaten, he barely looked alive. Blood poured from his body, from the thorns upon his brow. I watched him as he struggled. I watched him as he fell. The cross came down upon his back. The crowd began to yell. In that moment I felt such agony. In that moment I felt such loss. Until a Roman soldier grabbed my arm and screamed, "You! Carry his cross." At first I tried to resist him, then his hand reached for his sword. And so I knelt and took the cross from the Lord. Placed it on my shoulders and started down the street. The blood that he'd been shedding was now running down my cheek. They led us to Golgotha. They drove nails deep in his feet and hands. And yet, while he was on that cross, he cried, "Father, forgive them." Never have I seen such love in any other's eyes. Into thy hands I commit my spirit. He prayed, then he died. I stood what seemed like for years. I'd lost all sense of time until I felt two tiny hands holding tight to mine. My children stood there weeping. I heard the oldest say, "Daddy, please forgive us. The Lamb ran away." Daddy, Daddy, what have we seen here? There's so much that we don't understand. So I took them in my arms, and I turned facing the cross, and I said, "Dear children, watch the I hope that gives you a picture of what Jesus went through for us. Because the Bible doesn't tell us how often to take communion. It just tells us that when we do it, to do it in remembrance of me. So it's a time for us not only to confess and examine ourselves, but a time to reflect. And Paul, in 1 Corinthians, said that he received these instructions from the Lord. And mine is not cooperating. Of course. So he said, when he took the bread, King Jesus, what he did at the Last Supper, disciples. And remember, Jesus said he took the bread, and he told the disciples, he says, this bread signifies my body, which was given for you. And he gave thanks. Father, we thank you for your unconditional love for us. We thank you that you were willing to come to this earth in the form of Jesus and to give yourself for us. May we in turn give ourselves to you and to this world to bring the gospel. It says, after he had given thanks, he said, take, eat this bread, for it signifies my body. He goes on, he says, in the same way, he took the cup, and Jesus reminded them, said, this cup signifies my blood, which is now the new covenant. Remember the old covenant, based upon the blood of animals and the sacrificial system. He says, from now on, this new system of being right with God is because of the blood of Jesus. Father, we thank you. Not only for giving yourself, but we thank you for the death of Jesus. Thank you for the blood that was shed. Father, we know we cannot be good enough. We cannot earn forgiveness. Trust solely on the sacrifice of Jesus. Amen. And he said, and after he gave thanks, took the cup and said, drink, for this is the blood of the new covenant. And I like, in most of the gospel accounts, it says, and after the disciples left that Last Supper with the Lord, after the Lord's Supper, it says, and he left singing a hymn. We're going to sing a little chorus, oh, how he loves you and me. And then we're going to do something after that. But let's sing. Go ahead and stand with me. Oh, how he loves you and me. Oh, how he loves you and me. Don't forget, it says, as often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me until I come again. Remember, Paul Harvey used to close his shows, said, and that's the rest of the story. The rest of the story will be next week. All right. So those that join us online, we're going to say goodbye to you. Thank you for joining us online today. We look forward to the day when we see you in person. We hope the Lord has used this service to strengthen and encourage you. If you have any questions about the message or are considering giving your life to Christ,
please leave your contact information on our webpage or our Facebook page with a request to speak to me, Pastor Mike Dillin. If you have a prayer request, we would also like to know that as well. Immanuel Southern Baptist Church is in your corner, looking forward to a bright future. God bless everyone.